Hi everyone, this is Joanna Johnston. Hopefully you guys can hear me better. I just wanted to say that I did a really awesome radio show a couple nights ago and with Shauna Holm, who's a shaman, author, and spellbreaker. And why she's a spellbreaker, she breaks the trance of mind control, pretty much, that people have been under a big, deep spell for many centuries through her medicinal plants, which is the mushroom. So it's very, very exciting, and I think you guys are going to enjoy it. Actually, I know you guys are going to enjoy it very much because I was in complete awe the whole time of the show. So I think you guys, I really believe that you need to listen to this. She's very well versed in the sovereignty movement. She's very educated with sovereignty and knows what the commercial, what commerce is all about, and we had a really great conversation on there. So, I mean, it all goes hand in hand, and she also has a book out, which is absolutely awesome, and you're going to totally enjoy it. What she talks about is how she's able to communicate with spiritual energies or beings when she is under this medicinal plant, and this is something that we used to do many, many centuries ago, and I'm speaking for our ancestors before the whole virus spread, I would have to say the whole patriarchal god type virus spread, and when everyone else was totally living along nature, mother nature, goddess belief, and I mean there were god belief and god goddess and god belief, whatever, but they were very open to nature, and there was not so much of that virus that spread, like, oh, you better believe this or you're going to die if you don't. And it, I mean, it was just horrible. And it's always so important to look to the past, because the past will give you some clues to how people used to live. And if you look to the Native Americans, the indigenous tribes that are living now, how they are very in harmony with the Mother Earth, which is extremely important, because if you're believing in something that is going against the human body to make you feel less important in your life, from my studies, from what I have been doing a lot of research with the Dead Sea Scrolls, a lot of it came from the Zadokites. Please look that up, Google it. The Zadokites were a major zealot group who was very violent. And this is going way back in the time when Abraham was around in the Old Testament. A lot of the virus started spreading through that belief system where you're totally cut off from God, you're not good enough. And this is so opposite of how a lot of these other like indigenous tribes lived, and they were in so much harmony with Mother Earth. They loved, you know, all the animals, and they again lived in so much harmony, and they were happy people, you see. So we talk a lot about that, and because this virus thing, this belief system, and not saying that you know you have to believe, it's not really about believing in a superior being that's better than you or anything like that. Throughout the centuries, it also has changed, you see, changed into other things. So now it's not the superior being much anymore. It's more of believing in money and how money has really got us trapped, or the world of commerce, basically. Really, it's the world of commerce and corporations, you know, having us believe that, oh, to be very wealthy and rich is the way to go. You know, and even I have also noticed, like with law of attraction and all that, oh, believe, you know, just put your mind out there that you're going to get a Ferrari. And, you know, of course, obviously they want you to do that, because when you make a lot of money, guess the tax people win, right? The IRS is going to come knocking at your door. The more money you make in the United States, the more money that's going to be taken from you. So it's enslavement, complete enslavement. And I love how she talks about the citizen, what citizen means, which comes from the Rome. It's a Roman word. And it means slave. Doesn't mean that, oh, you're a great citizen, you're just a member of the society. No, you are considered a slave. So this is absolutely amazing. Please listen to the show and definitely get her awesome book. I'm going to be downloading that book myself. I only do Kindle, you know, because I'm extremely impatient when it comes to let me see what the book is called again. I know I'm so bad. It's absolutely wonderful book. And I've only read a few pages of it, but right away it was like I was totally hooked. It is, let's see here. Yeah, and of course, In His Image is a really good book too. In His Image by John Lash, you definitely need to read if you want to know what the heck I'm talking about when it comes to the virus, the religious virus that crept into human society. You really definitely need to read, because if you're going to be praying to something and worshiping something and being a part of religion that has to do with going against your human body, the beauty of yourself, you really want to do your due diligence before you really throw yourself into that. It's very important, because this has been going on for centuries, thousands of years. Okay. And it is called, okay, Love and Spirit Medicine by Shauna Holm. And you definitely going to dig it, because again, it's all about going within. You know, we are looking too much into the external world for answers, when all reality, we need to be bringing it into the internal world, going within, like the Gnostics did, like the pagans did, like the people, the indigenous tribes still do. They take their medicines, or they go into a deep trance or meditation, and they go within for answers, and they communicate with their source, their higher beings, in love, in harmony. And it's always in harmony with the planet. It's not going against, you know, like the river, like putting your raft up against the river and going against with violence and trying to push stuff down people's throats. No, it's about going within and being in harmony. And if you're in total vibration with it, you know, it's going to call to you. It's going to feel right. And people are going to be more open. And it's just absolutely amazing, you guys. You need just listen to the show first and then decide what you want to do with that, because I would say after you listen to the show, you're going to be like, I'm going to get this book completely. This is absolutely amazing. And the way she speaks is just so wow. We'll blow your socks off. You know, very, very informative, wisdom, wise woman. Okay. Have a wonderful day and enjoy.
Blog Talk Radio.
Hi, everyone. I'm finally back. Sorry about that. Hope you guys can hear me much better now. Please let me know if you can hear me better. All right. Okay, I get a yay here. Okay, good. Wonderful. Okay, this is perfect. Okay, good. I just wanted to make sure. So sorry about that. Let's see, I'm just going to heighten my sound here. And that's just how it is, electrical stuff, you know, it's how it goes. All right, I sound better. Yeah, it's my beautiful iMac. I think it's working better than my little Mac, so I'll hop on this big guy, this bad boy here. Okay, let me go ahead and get Shauna on. Okay, Shauna, you there? Hello? That's the wrong one, I think. Let's see. Okay.
I'm here.
Is this you? Oh, Shauna, is that you?
Yeah.
Okay,
you hear me?
Wow, you sound really clear right there. Wow.
Oh,
okay.
Good.
Perfect.
Wonderful. So do you. Okay, great.
All right, let's get going here. Let's get going. All right. So tell me about how you got into what you're doing now. I mean, into the plants. It's very exciting. I was looking at your book last night, and I found it to be extremely exciting. I got, like, chills running down my back. Like, oh, my God, this is so awesome, because you're talking about how to break the spell or the mental programming that we have been dealing with, and through plants, which I found it to be pretty interesting.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I've always, you know, for the past several years, I mean, I've known that, you know, we've got, other than friendly forces kind of running the show. I mean, that I've kind of always known, right, because I've been pretty awake. But
yeah.
2 years ago, really 2 years, was it 2 years ago this month? Yes. I began working with plant medicine, and I've been practicing shamanism for, God, probably a good 8 years now. You know, I just came into it just so smoothly, so effortlessly, and felt like everything I had sought my whole life, you know, brought me to this, you know, and so it's been my spiritual practice, and I also teach it. So I live in the Pacific Northwest, and I'd never worked with plant medicines before, and I don't, I really don't drink. I don't do recreational anything. Yeah, I just don't, you know,
wow.
Everyone was talking about the ayahuasca. And,
I like to know about the ayahuasca. Interesting.
Yeah, well, you know, I wanted to do it, but I was hearing a lot of stories about very irresponsible shamans helping themselves sexually to women on the medicine. And that's going on a lot. And at the same time, there are a few unbroken ayahuasca lineages where that medicine and the ceremony is held with the highest integrity. And then there's just a lot of guys out there making a lot of money off of unsuspecting and naive and eager Westerners. All right. So I was lamenting about the dearth of women ayahuasca shamans. And so then, like, within a month, I hear about these two women leading a circle of all women for ayahuasca. So I had that experience, and I did it like 3 or 4 times, but it came to me like, you know what? This is not your medicine. This is not your path. I just knew. And I was like, all right.
Wow.
But I felt the, but I felt the mushrooms calling me. And so this went on for a few months. And then a dear friend of mine who I had been, you know, friends with for a couple of years, and we were in a 2-year shamanic intensive with a teacher together. And so he had a lot of experience with plant medicines in general. And so he really initiated me into the mushroom medicine and like out on his property in the woods outside. It was really beautiful. And that was 2 years ago in July. And then and I had such a profound experience. And the way he did it was I then began listening to a lot of Terrence McKenna, who I'm sure you know Terrence McKenna, who spoke mm-hmm. prolifically on the sacred mushroom, and he wrote books and whatnot, and he's all over YouTube, mm-hmm. and he died in 2000. So Terrence advocated doing 5 grams of dried mushrooms in the dark, lying down, eyes closed. And so we figured we would do it that way. So that was, you know, that's a big dose, and it's actually too much for most people. Actually, don't recommend that. It's too
right.
much. but that's the way I did it, and I had a profound experience, and the earth spoke to me, and I received a very powerful healing, and it blew my mind. And so then, you know, I got home, and all I could think of was that experience, and I started really researching this medicine, like, what is this? You know, like, I didn't really know that much about the mushroom. I just knew it was calling to me. And actually, I'll say real quick, months before that, I was working with my shaman teacher in the Yucatan, and we spoke about the mushroom medicine, and he said, Shauna, just know that you don't find the medicine. The medicine finds you. And I understand that now, because I think I know, actually, this hunger that a number of people are experiencing for wanting to, desiring to experience plant medicines, this is Mother Earth calling her children back to her, calling her sons and daughters back. How? Through her plants. This is what's happening because, as you well know, we've entirely forgotten ourselves. We've become lost unto ourselves, and it didn't just happen 50 years ago. It didn't just happen, you know, 100 years ago. This has been going on, you know, for centuries, you know, probably thousands
yep.
of years, right? This
yep.
is, you know, a long, drawn-out thing. And so,
mm-hmm.
anyway, so then I went back to his house a month later, and I worked with it again. And what was happening was progressively with that medicine, beings were coming into me, and I was having these beautiful experiences with these beings, like a meeting of the minds or whatever, or a meeting of the frequencies, which is probably closer to the truth.
Wow.
And then they began animating me. And so, you know, I was having these very unusual experiences. And so all the while I'm researching, and this is a very long-winded answer to your question, but I'll finish in a minute. So what happened was, because this we do get back to the book, I read, I don't know, 40 or more books on entheogenic mushrooms. All but two were written by men. And they were great books, really great. And I'm a voracious researcher, and I can be in my head even too much, you know. So
oh,
great,
yeah. Welcome
right?
to the club. Welcome to the club.
Yeah, yeah. But yeah. What I was seeking was, where's the woman's experience? Where's the woman's and I don't need a woman's academic experience either. Where
Thank
is
you.
A woman's – where is the telling – of what this medicine, of the applicable use of this medicine in like, you know, the day in the life, a day in the life of someone, because I was going through the end of a marriage. I then became romantically involved with this medicine partner, this friend who became a lover, and then that collapsed and I got sent into my core wound. I mean, it was such an incredible, devastating, and extraordinary journey that I was on anyway, and then couple that with what happened, what became a monthly use of monthly, very reverent, very shamanic immersions into that medicine, and my experience was profound. And so I'm a writer, and I just started writing about it, and then produced this book, Love and Spirit Medicine, which is available on Amazon. And
awesome.
It is if you read part of it, it's a very vulnerable, personal telling and essential right now, and risky to do, but essential.
Oh yeah, I have to tell you about my experience on mushrooms myself. I've had a couple experiences, and I tell you, years ago, when I was 23 years old, we did it in an apartment, and I didn't get the exact great experience like you would to be around plants. When you're around plants, it totally changes the whole atmosphere to me. Right. It was really different. Like, even if I, you know, I did it with a girlfriend of mine recently, I think about a couple years ago, who's also, she's a high priestess as well. And I had a great experience with her, but I think what happened was my issue was the issue with my heart. Like, I thought that I was dying, because you go through the dying experience,
mm-hmm,
and I went through it, like, mm-hmm. so many times. She goes, you know, you got to be a powerful magician now in order to do this. You got to beat the fear of dying. And I'm just like, I don't understand what you're talking about. And I was just freaking out. And but it wasn't until I finally went outside, you know, on her porch, and it was surrounded by these beautiful plants, and I, like, laid there all day, all night, and it was the most amazing experience. I'm like, wow, these plants look so alive. Like, mm-hmm. it's the greatest feeling. And Yeah, I mean you're really tapping into something, a different part of your brain, and I would say it's actually kind of a deprogrammer, wouldn't you say?
Yes, it is. It is. I liken it to taking the red pill in the Matrix. Now, that is, they talk about set and setting being essential, and I've actually taken that several steps, further, and I have put it always in a ritual context, because this is medicine. This is a sacrament. Like I don't call myself a tripster. I don't, you know what I mean? Like, not in it for the visuals. I mean, the visuals are extraordinary, but you know what I mean? It's a very shamanic, very, very sacred endeavor for myself. And I always say the face you show is the face you get back. So when you create that kind of reverent ritual around it, and then you enter, you take the sacrament, and then I call it going through the portal to sit on God's lap and talk to the spirits, and the death experience is very common. It's like a dissolving. And I've had it happen a number of times, and it is scary, and because you're dissolving. And you don't think you're gonna return, I mean, it's quite amazing. And the thing is, we do not have in this culture, because this culture is an artificial construct that is sterile and devoid of any meaning whatsoever. So therefore, we have no recognized shamans. We have no touchstone for the use of these sacred medicines, which have been used by every single culture in some form, whether they are psilocybin mushrooms or fly agaric or cannabis or any number of ibogaine, ayahuasca, right? I mean, there's so many, many, many psychedelic plants out there worldwide, and only in the last 100 years or so have these medicines been made illegal. I mean, anyway, I mean, they're going to make they're going to make anything that grows illegal very soon. So it's just mind-boggling. This is something that grows in the ground. I mean, I pick mushrooms from the ground, gifts from Mother Earth. This is, and we are Earth. This is our birthright. And so what they are is they are medicines of consciousness. And that's the other thing. They're not drugs. That's not the same thing as a drug. And drugs have become very taboo in this society. And there's all sorts of just propaganda around this, and nothing that people have been told is the truth about these substances. They're profound medicines of consciousness, and they will open your eyes to both yourself, because they amplify the deep psyche and the conscious mind, and so they will bring to your awareness different maybe issues that need addressing. They will bring to your conscious mind anything you've been running from. So they can result in a very, it can be a very challenging and uncomfortable experience. Some would call that a bad trip, but I call that a very challenging experience. And that's also why, it's very important to do this with a sitter or a guide. And that's the other really tragic thing about this medicine being illegal, made illegal, is, someone like myself would be a hell of a good guide. Someone like your priestess friend would probably be a hell of a good guide. You'd want someone like that who could, just assist you through that piece, because you always come out on the other side and you get a healing every time, because you are working with a plant teacher, and many, many teachers that you will encounter through that portal.
Right, I agree. I mean, especially like some of the Native Americans, from what I was hearing in the military, that they have the military actually allows it. I think I forgot what Native American branch they were. They were allowed to have peyote, like, for their ritualistic use. They were actually able to do that, because that's their birthright. That's their, that was his birthright. He had the right to do it. So they actually allowed him to do it. But it's funny. It's like, oh, they can allow him to do it, but they should be able to allow us to do it too. I mean, they had so much control over us. I can just go on and on, but
I know. But this is. But first of all, you know what we need to do, Joanna. First of all, is the very idea that we are looking to another human being to give us permission, to give us rights. No one can give you rights. Your rights are inherent. So we are not under, we are all, you know, we're under divine law. And divine law, which is creator's law, says you do no harm.
Exactly.
But then man has overstepped that, and man's laws are supernatural, which is Latin, super meaning above natural, above nature. Man's laws go above nature. They write the stuff down. It's full of statutes, which is a statement of compulsion, and codes, which is hidden, all right? And then it's got one after another, after another, after another, and they say, I have authority over you, and then before you know it, you're in a tyranny. And that is unlawful. It may not be illegal, but legal is not the same thing as lawful, put it that way. And so, you know, this is what I was struggling with when I went to the MAPS conference in April, the Multidisciplinary Association of Psychedelic Studies, where they had all these researchers, and they were talking about just this extraordinary research, right, on MDMA and psilocybin and ibogaine and what MDMA can do for people with PTSD, intractable PTSD, which is so many of our good men who have, you know, been deceived and sent off to fight in a war for a corporation. No one understands that. In any case, these are good guys. These are good guys, and they're egregiously abused, and then they're given psychotropic drugs there, and then they come back here and they're given just terrible drugs, and they've got this awful PTSD. And okay, so MDMA has shown in these studies it cures them, so it alleviates suffering, and psilocybin alleviates suffering, you know, depression, all of this, right? And yet these substances are illegal, and they're considered what is it, the Section 1 drugs or whatever they're called. And in any case, what I was thinking in my mind, and, you know, these researchers were saying, well, we're hoping that by 2020 they will make MDMA, you know, legal for whatever psychotherapist to work with or whatever. And I was thinking, okay, wait a minute, why are we sublimating ourselves to, or supplicating these people
exactly.
who are in charge?
Like,
because,
thank you.
You know, aren't they supposed to be, aren't they charged with, you know, aren't they working for us, right? Because we have people suffering.
Right.
And there is more than enough evidence, thank you very much, that these substances are medicines. They are not addicting. On the contrary, they actually alleviate addiction. You know, they're not harmful, blah, 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 right? And so, but see, what no one realizes, which you, I'm sure, do know, is this is not a government. It's a corporation. They're not working for us. They're working for their friends. These are all attorneys. These are all attorneys. And then all of this goes back to the Bible, really, which is a metaphor. No one wants to read the Bible.
I wanted to throw that. That's exactly what I've been studying. There's a book called Not in His Image by John Lash.
I tell everybody to
get that book. And I was reading, my eyes were about to fall out of my eye sockets yesterday because I'm reading like crazy. And I'm finding out exactly where this biblical stuff was coming from. And they're talking about the Zadokites, which was from the Dead Sea Scrolls that they had to keep hidden, and they were a fanatic group. Like, they would be your Waco today, okay? And they were so fanatical, they actually brought it into the religion, and it's the only religion that talks about, you know, going against the human body. And, I mean, we can go on and on about it, but, yeah, it goes all the way back to that and how they had a communication with some of these other off-world entities that were not really fond of the human species. That could be a possibility. So it's very funny how this law, which has been passed on through generations to today, is not different. The only thing that's different is we're not, you know, saying, hey, you're a pagan, I'm a Christian type of thing. Now it's more of, hey, you need to follow the law. Oh, you're not following the law? Oh, you're a terrorist now.
Well, the thing too that they do is they pit us against each other. And
exactly.
that is the Hegelian dialectic, which is the box. So there's always two sides. Republican, Democrat, liberal, conservative, pro-choice, pro-life, blah, 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 and they pit us. Men and women are pitted against each other. It's just constant. Mm-hmm. And so then we use the legal system, and this is the other piece, too. The legal system, it is not public law. Public law protects you from harm. Private law, that's what this is. Private law benefits from your harm. They want us suing each other. They want us fighting. They want us hurting each other and then taking each other to court, which is a private, it's a bank. And then
right.
you show up
That's
there
true.
Not as you, the human being. You show up there as a straw man, and they immediately begin to administer, and they make money off of you. And so
mm-hmm.
the entire system, just suffice to say,
it's patriarchal.
Is immoral.
And
it's,
patriarchal.
Well, it is immoral.
It's like, where's
and
the women at?
Is, yeah, but the whole idea of being patriarchal, whether you are being patriarchal to a religion or to a state or a country, you are worshiping a false father, right?
Right.
And so,
I agree.
And this goes back again to the Bible, where Jesus was like, he said, "I and the Father are one," meaning I and the Father, God, and you can think of God however you want, God, goddess, earth, mother,
exactly.
father, whatever. We'll just call it God for the sake of argument. You are God. And so there's a fabulous woman named Tammy Pepperman who teaches so much about this. And one of the things she says, and this really spoke to me, she says, you know, we're God. We've forgotten.
Yep.
And she says, how do you subjugate a God? You tell God, at a very young age, you're not God. God is outside of you. So that's mean trick
mm-hmm.
number one.
Mean
yep. trick number two, then you say to that young one, oh, but there's a Savior. So to the Christians, that Savior is Jesus. And then to a lot of the New Age people, the Savior is the UFO Pleiadians, whoever
yep.
they are apparently going to be landing
exactly.
any day now. And then, you know, for the,
exactly.
the all of us, the Savior mm-hmm. is the Savior is that special man or special woman who you're going to meet. So what it does is it sets
soulmate.
You up, but it sets you up for the rest of your life
right.
to seek outside of yourself for that something that is going to save you or complete you or make you whole. Do you see? And so you
oh,
never
yeah.
look
it's a
within,
sickness.
And that's mm-hmm. where it's at. And so how? What does that
Very
have to do
true.
With mushrooms? This is the level of consciousness as a result of working with this medicine that that has really opened me to this, because when I go into the mushroom medicine, I speak with what I call beings. And I don't really call them spirits. I call them beings, because just as we are human beings, they are beings too, just in a different realm. And they teach me with coyote teachings. And so coyote teachings are where they're not going to give you all the answers to the test. They're not going to give you the whole deal, right? They'll give you clues. They'll give me clues. They'll give me little things they'll say. And then I am expected, why? Because I'm a high being myself and I've got, you know, a brain in my head. I am then expected to go and do my research and do my digging and chew on
right.
those bones, right? And then I get to have the aha moments, you know, and different things will synchronistically appear. And, you know, but it's, and what they are saying to me anyway is, we are not your authority. We are not going to do this for you. And we are your assist. We're your assist. We're going to give you a little help here. You know, but then
right.
you're going to do this. You're going to do this because you're the Christ, you know. You're
right.
the one. You've got it going on.
Shauna, I have to say,
yeah.
this is so amazing that we're talking about this. Like, I've been going on this journey this past couple weeks just recently, you know, going within, you know, I joined the divineprovince.org. I was reading some of their documents. It's very heavy-duty stuff, diplomatic immunity. And, I mean, it's just very, very deep stuff. And then it just caused me to say, hey, you know what, I'm going to go look more. I need to go past this. I need to go back to history and really go back in history and do a lot of research, you know. And then what you're saying about the whole Christ Redeemer programming, we call it, everything that's going on, it's the Christ Redeemer programming, saviors in the aliens, saviors in this. We're always looking outside ourselves for that
mm-hmm.
answer
mm-hmm.
when we should be looking within. And this is like a really awesome answer here of you delving more into the mushrooms, because it is an internal thing. I mean, what do you think our ancestors were doing most of the time? They were all shamans. They were Gnostics. They were pagans. You know, they did a lot of stuff with with plants. It even shows it on caves from what Graham Hancock was talking about.
Mm-hmm.
He did a lot of research how they would morph, like the goddess would morph into like an animal, a lot of morphing going on. But they were doing a lot of this stuff because they were tuning into their other inner realities and communicating with their source. And yeah, you pretty much hit it on the nail with that. That is so interesting. So you think that if more people could start going back to those ways and start tapping in to their highest potential through these medicinal plants, you think that this could really help evolve humanity?
Absolutely, and yet it must be done with reverence, right? This is
right.
not about going to a nightclub and shrooming or doing your LSD or whatever. It's not about going. This is the other thing I'm seeing with this younger set, too. They're using this as a way to get, like, laid, like group sex and all this stuff. And,
And
I know that there's, like, a tantric deal, but you know what I mean? Like, I'm seeing through a lot of that, too. I'm like, you know what? I'm not a spring chicken. I know what you guys are doing. Cut the shit, you know? But, absolutely. I mean, what we are doing is this is not new. This is very, very old, and we are reclaiming something very, very old and very, very sacred. And really, you know, what I have been told on the medicine is that we are in the garden. This is the garden, Earth. This is paradise. And we have a beast in the garden. All right,
yep.
It's all biblical. It's all old. We got a beast in the garden, or you could think of it as, you know, Mama, because I call Earth Mama. Mama has cancer, and it's systemic. All right, so
right.
we are the white blood cells who are remembering and gathering our strength again. You know, and then, you know. The more strength we have, the more we go, we'll put it this way, you know, I describe myself as a shaman and spell breaker, and on my website I say that I take people out of the you know, cultural, delusional, whatever, and into the territory of the sacred. Well, what is the territory of the sacred? You're the territory of the sacred. And so I bring people into their own, I'm like, go into your own ground. That's where the passion is. Connect with your will again. Your will is divine. You know, people have lost their will. They've lost all will to, they have no fight in them. You know, like you got to connect to that. And it's all within you. And this is the piece too. I think, they have... social engineering, by the way, it didn't just start with like Skinner and all these guys at the beginning of the 20th century. Social engineering's been around for thousands of years, you know. I mean, the temple magicians, the dark ones, they knew exactly how to pull the wool over.
About
spells. It's all about spells. And that's the bottom line. And so we are, the entire planet's essentially being spellbound. And so what are we doing? We're waking up from a spell. We're breaking a spell. And at least this is, again... This comes to me from the medicine. I haven't read this in any book. The beings have been explaining
this
to me.
Wow. Now that is how it's supposed to be.
Yes. That's exactly
awesome.
Right. That's exactly right. So why do you think one of the main reasons these medicines are illegal, as you said, they help you deprogram? Because we live in a, I'm always playing with words, we live in a culture,
mm-hmm.
right? So we are deprogramming ourselves.
Right.
From that, and the medicine will help you do that. But again, because there is no touchstone for this, and because we have people who are so unconscious, you know, an experience, a deep experience with a medicine can be highly challenging. And also because it does, you know, you question your reality, you know,
right.
and that can be very unnerving to a lot of people because they think that sort of what we have in society, like that's reality. It's like, no, sweetie, no. As a matter of fact, it's a construct. There's no such thing as Seattle, where I supposedly live. There's no such thing as Canada. There's no such thing as borders. There's no such thing as corporations. All of that is held together. It's a construct held together by, you know, our consent. You know?
Right.
And
exactly.
It doesn't, it's no different than we're just playing dress ups and then those guys put on a uniform, so now they're, you know, a policeman or a soldier or a whatever, you know what I mean? And it's just Shakespeare said it best, all the world's a stage. He knew back then this is artificial, this isn't real. So nature's real. we've entirely forgotten, and now we're in the mess we're in. But it's like there is a way out. My sense here is it's like, you know, we need extreme measures are needed, right? And this is where the mm-hmm. plant medicines come in, because they do sort of give you that kind of slap in the face to realize, oh, wait a minute, what have I been doing? First of all, what have I been doing in my own life? You know what I mean? What the heck?
Right.
What
exactly.
was I thinking? And then mm-hmm. you look around and you say, whoa, this is immoral, because it is. This
and
is
it
immoral,
doesn't go along.
Goodness.
It doesn't go along with humanity, and that's the thing. You know, I realize, you know, religion or spirituality needs to be like water. It has to be like nature. It goes along with nature. Any type of religion or belief system that goes against the human body is like going up a river stream. It doesn't
yeah,
make any sense.
No, and it's language in general, because mm-hmm. words are spells. That's where spelling a word came from. Words are spells. And so words can be used to uplift people or to imprison. And that's the other piece, too. And this goes back to Babylonian, you know, to Babel, right? To confusing people, okay?
Right,
so
right.
We are, there's two types of language going on in this society right now, which nobody understands. We have legalese, and legalese is the legal jargon. And that comes from their book of spells, which is called Black's Law Dictionary, which really mm-hmm. is the book of the dead, because law, legal stuff, it's a fiction. It's a dead
right.
thing. It's a story. It's you know what I mean? And so
mm-hmm.
that's one language. That's why people say, I don't understand, how can a corporation be a person? Wait a minute. You know what I mean? But it's like, well, dear, that's because the legal definition of person is a franchise. You know, it's an
right.
entity, a corporation, you know, it's not a
mm-hmm.
human being. That's
right.
a different deal. So, you know, people are not understanding, you know, like something's being spoken to them from the White House, which is in itself a temple, and those people are
mm-hmm.
attorneys. The
exactly.
attorneys are the landlords, and so we have been fornicating with the landlord, again, going back to biblical, you know what I mean? We've given
it
our body over to...
Yep.
Yeah, we've given our body over to the landlord.
Right,
you know?
And the judges.
And yeah, and right, and the judges, when in reality no one can judge you.
Right.
No one. So, gosh, you and I mean, I had a feeling, I was like, oh, God, this conversation is going to just go crazy. I can feel
it. I know.
It.
No,
but
it's amazing.
Assume your listeners are probably pretty sophisticated.
Oh, yeah. Oh, they're loving it. Oh, yeah. They're so right on. They know exactly what we're talking about. You know, they've been pretty, pretty educated. And, yeah, you know, and a lot of times, especially in the sovereign groups or the SPC groups, the Cure Party Credit groups, you know, a lot of times they, you know, there's a lot of conflicts of, oh, how we should do our forms or paperwork and all that. Let's go look at the Constitution and yada, yada. But really, I'm saying, you know what, it's time to go way back, because it goes farther back than the Constitution. The Constitution is constituted for debtor. So
right,
it,
you don't, but
it,
you don't want a constitution.
Exactly.
You,
exactly.
That's what you get, an empty vessel. And this goes back to the Sestwe KV Act of 1666, great year, of course, you know, where the Great Fire of London happened. And so London was burning to the ground. And one of the buildings that burned to the ground was the building that had all the birth records in it. And then during that Great Fire, while London was burning, Parliament met. Now, they didn't have cell phones. They didn't even have phones. So how they knew in all that chaos to meet, I wonder. They met, and they came up with the Sestwe KV Act, which actually was enacted by the Pope, I think, a few centuries before that. But they brought it forward, and it basically means from where do you live? They put it in Latin first so that the uneducated – the great many who are uneducated wouldn't even understand what it meant. Only the very wealthy would. And then they changed it to French, Sestwe KV. But essentially what that did was say, well, all the birth records are gone. So these people don't even really exist. So they've got about 7 years to show up and prove that they are living. Otherwise, we will administer their estate. And by estate, they mean the body. Your
right.
body is
oh,
the
gosh.
Real estate. Real estate
mm-hmm.
is your body, okay? And then the Declaration of Independence, or the Bill of Rights, you know, they just basically brought the Sestwe KV over to this country with the Bill of Rights and the Declaration of Independence, which is the declaration of being in dependence.
Right.
And then when you break down dependence more, you say what it means is you're in a pending state. You're not dead, but you're not alive. You're always pending. You never are. You never are.
Wow.
And so you're considered an empty vessel because this is maritime law. This is maritime
right.
law. We're in the sea of commerce. So you are berthed, B-E-R-T-H-E-D, berthed, and docked, you know, with the dock tour. I mean, I love all their words. It's great jokes on us. In any case, and then you're given that birth certificate, right? And you are filled with what? A constitution. Do you see what I mean? We don't need
right.
a constitution.
No.
We don't need to be given rights. Our rights are inherent. No one, if anyone gives you anything, you've just enslaved yourself. No one
right.
tells you your rights.
Right.
And also, equal rights are for slaves. That's what you tell slaves. And so the whole piece with the Sestri KV Act, and then it goes back to the papal bulls and blah, 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 is we are God. We are kings. You're a king. I'm a king or a queen, whatever. We're kings. See, and I'll tell you what. So we're talking about all this. Guess how I came into this? I didn't know about any of these sovereignty groups. I didn't know about any of this stuff. No, I worked with the mushrooms, and these beings were working with me. And so the first clue that I was given was last fall when I was in the Yucatan, and I had taken a group there, and I was with my shaman friend, and he took the group for the day to Palenque. And I was alone at Palenque, which I wanted to be, because 1,000 years ago, there was a queen who ruled Palenque, known as the Red Queen, or Lady Zakuk, and she was known for going into high trance states and bringing back information. Well, what do you suppose she was working with? She was working with the sacred mushrooms. There are mushroom statues up and down Guatemala and the Yucatan. All right? So I wanted to go talk to her.
Okay.
Because I talk to these beings the same way you and I are talking. So I do like a little bit of the medicine. I'm in a very quiet place on the grounds of Palenque. And before me is this woman's face. She's orangey red. She's got a headdress of feathers and then like serpent snakes between each feather. And she is eyeing me. And the serpents are eyeing me and they're studying me because that's what they do. They read your frequency. So then we proceed to have a discussion. Well, in that discussion, one of the things she said to me was, you are majestic beings, and you've been robbed of your majesty. And so when I went home, what I had begun doing by, you know, last summer, they taught me to do this, was to look up the etymology of words. Etymology is word origins. So the definitions, forget it. Because Webster and Oxford and those guys, they had their biases, and word definitions change with the times. You want to see what is the original intention of that word. So I thought, she called us majestic. Let me look that up. I look up majestic. The etymology is royalty.
Oh, wow.
We're royalty. You and I and everyone listening to this call and every man, woman, and child on this earth is royalty, and she said, but it was taken from you. It was taken from us a long, long time ago, right? And so we've been under a spell. And so a king does not ask for his rights.
No.
No one's
Heck
above
no.
a king. No one's above
exactly.
a king. And so then here's the other clue that they gave me later. I was on a medicine journey, and the trees were speaking to me. And at that point, I was calling myself an earth citizen, and the trees said, dear one, do not call yourself an earth citizen. Citizen is a Roman word.
Ooh.
You are an earth
wow.
sovereign. And I got out of that, and I'm like, huh, what does that mean? I thought I was a citizen. You know what I mean? And so then I started researching all of that. And I have a very dry book that I got from Scribed called The Law of Roman Slavery from Augustus to Justinian. Well, that I got one of those, oh, holy fuck moments reading that book because they talked about this is all Roman law. Mm-hmm. And the Romans were really good at keeping slaves. Well, a citizen is a slave. And then they talk
just
about
just
how
slaves.
These slaves were given specific values based on what they could do. Sound familiar? So like, okay, you're a doctor, you're worth about 300, you're a waitress, you're worth about 50, you know, you're a healer, oh, I guess maybe you're about 20, you know what I mean? So then what you're doing is you are giving people, you or someone is giving them choices, their choices of what they can do, and then based on what they do, then they are given a value of what they're worth. That is the antithesis of being human. You cannot put a value on a human being.
No, you see? Not at all. So, sounds like marketing. Sounds like complete marketing.
Yeah, and we've been in this system of commerce for, you know, at least a couple thousand years, longer than that, right? It's a system of it's not a true system. I mean, all the indigenous cultures that they would, you know, then pillage, they didn't have anything like that. They had trading,
no,
they had stuff like that.
Not at
they
all.
Didn't have.
Yeah,
they
were dealing with human beings,
were.
Not machines at the time. And right, yeah, exactly.
And we
I
were
agree.
That way too once. We were mm-hmm. that way too. We were heathens and deeply
yeah.
connected to the land and had communities, you know. And so this is sort of reclaiming of what we've got to bring back, and not to go back to dark ages or anything like that. Hell no. No, we've got
right.
great technology, but it's in the hands of the wrong people. It's in the hands of criminals, and it's being used against us instead of used to uplift us. Just as the TV, they don't call it programming for nothing. Right?
Right.
Be used to totally uplift
exactly.
people.
Exactly.
So, anyway, I mean, you know, there's
yeah,
work to be done.
Yeah, totally. I mean, that's why we don't like to watch the television. But again, there's programming no matter what. You know, you're driving down the road, you put on the radio station, there's that programming. You know, even on YouTube or internet, you know, with AOL news, there's always that type of programming. So it's been going on. I mean, it first started out with a lot of religious programming, and now they're moving into, I mean, they got all this high technology. And all this propaganda also started out in the Hitler days, especially, too. So, you know, a lot of, they were saying a lot of the people from Germany or Nazi Germany ended up coming into the United States and started doing their little magic there. So it's been going on for so long. It's like we don't know what to do. But at least I could say there is an awakening. People are like, you know what? We're finally able to ask a question. Wow, something doesn't feel right. You know, and that's like number one, to actually be able to have the courage to say, wait a second, something doesn't feel right. is this right? And then a lot of times you're asking about, oh, okay, this religion, this church, what's going on? Something doesn't feel right. You know, when we're starting to feel that, it's like the energies are shifting. We're all starting to shift in some way. And it's absolutely amazing, because now you're seeing a lot of the powers that be, how they're playing their parts, their roles. You know, like Alex Jones and David Icke, they're doing a lot. I mean, yeah, they're waking a lot of people up, but at the same time, it's like, okay, we need some empowerment now. It's time to be empowered.
That's the thing. Yeah, and, mm-hmm. and I want to say something about Alex Jones, because
okay,
I don't entirely
ahead.
Trust him. I think, mm-hmm. yes, he's waking people up, but he offers no remedy.
Exactly.
Speaking
yep.
in legal terms. Do you see? He mm-hmm. offers no remedy. All he does is stir people's emotions, and it makes me wonder, huh, has he been kind of planted here just to so that he gets people fired up enough that they will do what the powers that be want, and that is some kind of act of violence, so then they can impart martial law.
Yeah.
Do you see what
yeah.
I mean? And
I agree.
And
uh-huh.
then there are other people who are bringing through a tremendous amount of information about just what this system is that we are in, and how do we extricate ourselves from the system. Because the fact, and this is a fact I'm very sorry to say, every man, woman, and child around this planet right now is a slave. We are slaves via the birth certificate. That is a fact.
Yep. Yep.
And it goes on from there, and it is all done with our consent, but it's larceny by trick, because they have mistaken us. They have taken us, something that was, you know, lost, delivered, whatever, taken us at birth, and, you know, and they've been administering us ever since. And so we must understand this system we are in. We are in right now the book of Revelations in the Bible. And what is Revelations? It's the revealing. What does the apocalypse mean? It means to the unveiling. So we are being revealed to ourselves. We are beginning to see, some of us, wait a minute, I'm God. I'm
right.
God. Wait a minute.
Exactly.
I don't need to ask anyone to, you know, change the laws or to please forgive me or whatever this nonsense is. I'm God.
Mm-hmm.
Wait, and then turn to those people. Who are these people? And what
right.
what have they been doing? And then you have a responsibility then to really understand the system, and then they must provide remedy, meaning they must provide the means, you know, for us to extricate ourselves from that system. And that is done with no violence whatsoever. Not a single bullet fired, nothing. Withdraw your support.
Exactly. Very true. And your focus. You know how they're putting so much focus on a god or an entity. When you start to withdraw that energy from them, it's that. And then also what I did with Divine Providence, which was pretty interesting because they do supply some really awesome documents, and it's stating that you gain back your living trust, your estate, your estate, that's your that's you. And and by doing that, it's just basically, it's not a remedy, it doesn't have to be, it's just basically saying, here, you have been noticed, that's it.
But you have to be very careful.
Right,
very careful. And no one is to just, like, you know, the Tammy Pepperman and Franco Collins talk about, you got to give yourself a good, solid year of study.
Right.
Because if you go file the wrong documents, if you get called into court, because actually the last place you want to be is court, because it's not what you think. It's private law, not public. And the cards are stacked against you on purpose. It's a game, and it's a mean one, all right? You can wind up imprisoned.
Yeah.
So this is, I want really emphasize to people, because people are getting excited and, oh my God, we can really do this. Yes, you can, and you must understand. Or no, I don't want to say understand, because we know what understand really means. You stand under me. You must comprehend. You must, you know, and we must really comprehend what this system is. And I will also recommend Franco Collins. He's out of Australia. Yeah, 1-heaven.org, and read all the canon laws, because this goes back to papal canons. There's no separation between church and state at all. We're already in New World Order. The Vatican is the legal arm. That's the legal arm. The City of London is the financial, and District of Columbia is the military.
Right.
So we're already in it.
And so...
Go on,
it's okay. I told a lot of the people too, like, you know, Federal Reserve notes, Australian notes, or Canadian notes, or whatever. It's the same thing. We have been under New World Order for a very long time. It's not something brand new. It's something that has been done to us. It's been done.
No, it's just the gloves are off.
Gloves
are off, and there's nowhere to run anymore, because the technology, they can see through rocks. You know what I mean? And my sense also from a very expanded state is that, you know, they're doing their job. I mean, they're doing what they're supposed to do, right? I mean, you can call it evil and everything else, and it is. It's disgusting what they're doing. But we are being sort of really pressed up against a wall now, and it's like, okay, are we going to take action? Are we going to come into our godhood? Are we going to come into our power? Are we going to continue to play victim or be apathetic? There's so much apathy. That breaks my heart. The apathy really breaks my heart, you know?
Yeah.
Are we, you know, or say, because, and anyway, so it's really, we're in this, I think, remarkable, amazing, extraordinary time where this is about, we're in that revealing. Oh, I'm God. So I really can do this. I really can't. Everything I've been told is a lie. That's bad news, good news, isn't it? Because the good news is everything you've been told is a lie, which
so
means you really can heal.
Yeah,
you really can heal yourself. You really can, you know, affect extraordinary change. You really can experience and be joy. You really can. It's just all these shitty programs, you know, you and me, we've all been socially engineered. All of us, every last one of us.
So
let's, you know, we're deprogramming ourselves from that, but we've got to be smart about it. And that's where that spiritual maturity comes in, you know, where you don't rush headlong. You know, you've got to really be very grounded and also know thyself,
and
you know,
Shana,
clean up your own house. Yeah,
and I was wondering too if you've ever asked the beings when you were in this state of trance anything about the futuristic outcomes.
Well, okay, so they have said this. So what I've come into, I am a medicine oracle. I'm also a medicine midwife, a death and birth midwife via the medicine. But I'll go into the oracle piece, and now the medicine oracle has old, old, old. Think the Picea of Delphi
and
these women in the Norse tradition called Valva, V-O-L-V-A. They would go into high trance states and, you know, bring through, you know, the Norse pantheon of gods and goddesses and you know, people on the other side.
Ooh, I love
so
it.
this is old school, baby. So every so often I will go into Medicine Oracle for just a very small group of very trusted people. You know, I'm not going to, you won't see me going around the country channeling or any of this stuff. You know, it's just, this is very rare. But they came in, the beings, and there's different groups that I work with, primarily bird tribe. And by the way, I will quickly say my medicine is owl. Well,
I have to tell you, girl, real quick, Shauna.
Yeah, yeah.
My medicine is owl, too. It came to me my meditation, and it was a white barn owl.
Wow, because white owl, well, then you need to read my whole book. Wait till you get to the chapter called Daughter Who Knows, because white owl came to me and said, announced that she was my medicine. But what does owl do, sweetie? You know this. Owl sees in the dark. Owl sees what others can't, and owl sees what others won't. Right? So owl, I always joke, can be a bit of a wet blanket at times. It can be pretty difficult medicine to swallow, but we all must see. And I've noticed a tremendous amount of men and women who are coming into the owl, you know. It's coming to them very powerfully.
Wow.
And I know that the owl is coming in to say, all right, dear ones, you've been in the dark a long time. And it is now time to see. And then what they've also said is not just see, you know, the unpleasant stuff, and, you know, it's very important, yes, you see. And the beings have said to me also, we will not bring this information through the lens of fear. They said, your planet has been run on fear. It's the only language you know.
Wow.
No, you just must see and understand, because when you see and when you understand, because all of this is spells, like I said, right? What is legalese? What is Black's Law Dictionary? It's not called White's Law Dictionary. It's called Black's.
Exactly.
The book of spells, all right? And so when you see, then this spell doesn't work anymore, does it? Because you can see, all right? But then also what's in the dark that is being revealed is what we were just talking about. Hey, wait a minute. I'm God. Your beauty. The truth is being revealed. And the truth is that we are beings of we're human beings are extraordinary. Extraordinary beings. We are made to think we're polluters, we're sinners, we're terrorists, we're witches, we're treasonous. I mean, they have labeled us through history. You know, those are labels and they're wrong. Who do you think is doing the labeling? And who is creating the actions of those labels, really? You are known for your actions, right? So in any case, back to your question. So I went into Medicine Oracle in December. And so this group of beings I call the star beings came through. And I nicknamed them, I call them the raucous ones. They're very funny. And I looked up raucous, and it means disorderly. And I had to laugh because they're so fun, you know. But they said, look, you know, they said we've got a room full of worriers, they said. And they pointed to me. They said, this one's a big one, you know. And they said, look, you're going to figure it out. You will figure it out. You will, you know. But they said, you know, your race, the human race, you are at a crossroads right now. You're at a crossroads, and they said, you know, we are either going into an era of the greatest tyranny, the likes of which this planet has never seen.
Oh, my goodness.
Or, well, you can see that, right? That's evidence.
Right.
Or we are coming into extraordinary, creative, amazing existence on this planet, right? Because it's not true that we're overpopulated.
It's not true.
You know, all that
stuff.
We can have heaven. We can have heaven on earth. Why? Because we're in the garden. This is the garden, right? And so the biggest news that you'll never hear is this extraordinary awakening. And this is something else that the beings told me, because I always say, like, I don't worry about my girls. I don't really worry about myself. I worry about this planet a lot. I really do.
Yeah.
And the trees said to me also, they said, dear one, you are not fighting this fight by yourself. You don't have to do this by yourself. And when I say fighting this fight, I mean in terms of like a spiritual warrior.
Mm-hmm.
And a spiritual
right.
warrior seeks to know, you know, and seeks to help, right? So, but they were saying there are so many like you all over the world. And so those who are in charge, who've been in charge for thousands of years, right? Well, first of all, these are just a few families. They're very inbred. They are psychopaths. And
oh
I'm not
gosh.
Saying that lightly.
Mm-hmm.
A psychopath has no empathy. All right? And there is a level of arrogance and hell, I guess they've earned their arrogance because they've done quite well, right? I mean, hats off to these guys. They're diabolically brilliant. However, they are underestimating the human spirit. Don't you think? And I know that there are a lot of people who are apathetic and they're totally asleep and they couldn't give a rat's ass about this conversation. I know that. And that's probably the majority of people out there.
Right.
And yet, how many just good people with just such good hearts do you know? So many, right? So many people who would never harm anyone. They just, you know, and they see what's going on, and they really just sort of scratching their heads going, all right, what can we do? This is terrible.
Right.
You know? How do we do this, right? And so this is about, you know, re-membering, coming back into community and putting forth information. This is the age of light. And what is light? Light is information. That's what light is. We're in it. And I joke with my students who I work with, I say, you think the dark is scary? Oh, wait till you see what the light will do. Wait till you see, right? Because the light reveals everything. It's like, careful what you pray for, right? I mean,
exactly.
Really, we're seeing everything. But then the test is, okay, now what are you going to do? What are you going to do? Because there is work we can do on the energetic realm. There's no question. There's no question. I do that work. There's a lot we can affect energetically. And we're also here in the 3D.
Yep.
So
yep.
It's about, you know, 3D action.
Oh, yeah, and I'm getting a question, actually. Someone wants to know, how would you go about partaking with mushrooms?
How would you go about partaking in terms of the ritual? Can they clarify?
Yeah, is it the ritual, Michael? Michelangelo? I think so. I think it's the whole shebang. Like, how would you partake in what you're doing, the mushrooms and camping?
Okay. So I will clarify that, first of all, for myself, I don't lead any groups or anything like this. This I do for my own. It's like this is how I nourish. I go in myself into these realms, and then I come out and I share, you know, the wisdom that has come to me. And I encourage other people to do that. So if you're going to create a ritual context, you would – I always do this at night.
Since they are illegal. Okay, they just wrote me. Since they are illegal.
Since they are illegal. Right,
okay.
right. So you got to be very careful about, I mean, they grow all over the place, right? So, but you must be very, very careful because if you eat the wrong ones, you know, you can get really sick or worse. So, you know, do some due diligence online. Look for you know, there are books out there. There's a book by Paul Stamets called Psilocybin Mushrooms of the World, and that, you know, identifies different mushrooms and where they grow and whatnot. So do a lot of research there. And then you can kind of start looking for them, right? And, I mean, Mother Earth, you know, provides this for us, you know, and call to the medicine also. Call to it because that's the other thing. We are Earth. We are totally connected with these plants. We can communicate with the trees, the plants, all of this. So you put that out there that you wish for this to happen, and you call it to you, all right? So then when if you should find yourself in the presence of this medicine, mm-hmm. you know, I would recommend just a gram of dried to start, you know. I mean, you're much better mm-hmm. off doing too little than too much, especially if you're alone, you know. But preferably
right.
have a sitter or a guide with you. And then create ritual in terms of use some sage. If you can be outside, you know, if you want to be just under the stars in a sleeping bag or in a tent or something, and use some sage and walk in a circle 3 times with your sage, all right? What are you doing? You're casting a circle. which is very, very old, all right? You're casting a circle. You're creating your own temple, and you're creating a boundary, are you not? Because when you do these medicines, any of these, the shaman understands, you open yourself up. So you don't want any tricksters to get in, any sort of entities or anything like, you know what I mean? You want to say, look, I want to talk to some light beings here, but I don't want any trouble, okay? That's essentially what you're saying. And you sage yourself or use copal, you know, or whatever cleansing, you know, herb you've got, and you sage your mushrooms. And then I call in my allies. I mean, I call in Owl, you know, or, you know, the open the directions, that kind of thing. And I talk to Mother Earth, and I ask her to also protect me and speak to me, you know. And then I lie down on my back and have you know, eat the mushrooms and then just wait for it to kick in and then have the experience. So,
wow, very interesting.
Yeah, and because my eyes are closed, it is this totally interior experience, and it will usually start with the visuals, and those can be very, you know, all-encompassing, and you know, those come, and it's interesting because I'm like, okay, yeah, all right, you know, like I'm not so enamored of that, and then eventually that passes, and then it becomes a shamanic journey for anyone who's taken a shamanic journey with a rattle or a drum, but, you know, you're going really deep. Really, really deep, you know, and then that's my experience. And so, and the whole experience is it becomes felt and known, not so much visual, although there is visual as well. And so it is full communion with the sacred. So that is the experience. And then, you know, it's only done at certain times when you feel the compulsion, you know, you feel, oh, okay, this is feeling like, you know, next Sunday this needs to happen, you know. And then so you create this, it becomes something very sacred, right? It's not the same thing. You're not abusing. It's not about escapism. That's for darn sure.
No, it's not.
Escapism. It's the opposite of escapism because, you know, they cut to the truth and you're going into the truth of your being. You know,
yeah,
and you're going into the sacred.
Oh, yeah, I got another question. She wants to know, or they want to know, you call the mushrooms a sacrament. If you can go a little more further, what do you mean by that?
Oh, well, I mean, when you take a sacrament, you are taking something that's very sacred, are you not? In other words, that's delineating, this is not a casual thing, is it? No, a sacrament means something very holy, very sacred. So, yeah, that's what I'm saying, that this is, in other words, you know, this is not something I trifle with. It's not something I, you know, I mean, I've had great joy and laughter and whatnot with this, but it's like, it's not a joke, you know what I mean? It's not, it's not a casual, recreational, no, I mean...
Yeah. And they've done it all over the world. I mean, people all over the world, ayahuasca, especially peyote is really big. Mescaline. I've had experience with MDMA. That was my favorite drug ever. Ecstasy. I love that one because it really, I mean, we would have like, you know, I used to live in Virginia years ago. And every weekend we would have people come over and it was always centered on a spirituality. It was more like we do our yoga, we get our crystals, we light some incense, put some nice tunes, Enigma. We would really tune in and tap in, and we would be extremely connected with everybody, like just this amazing connection. And I actually did that with the shrooms at a couple of times. We used to call it hippie flipping, okay? That's what the stupid term was. But it was really, really deep, and you would actually go in and ask a lot of questions, and you would come out like very, like, wow, I really tapped into some amazing energies. I mean, I was doing that a lot in my early 20s, but of course, you know, the belief system kind of got a hold of me of, oh, no, that's bad. You know, you're a parent. You shouldn't be doing drugs, and you yada, yada, yada. You know,
right. And so then, I mean, I wouldn't even be sharing it, you know, because they don't understand. And for myself, okay, well, then what are you doing, Shauna? You've written a book about it. But I wrote a book in an endeavor, first of all, to bring this medicine back to its rightful place as a medicine of consciousness, and also to show that it can be approached in that way and that it can have a profound effect on your life, and particularly for someone like myself who was experiencing a lot of depression and went into a dark night of the soul during that experience. And rather than reaching for the usual suspects, which we are encouraged to do in this society, i.e., alcohol, antidepressants.
Right. That's the worst drug you could ever get into.
Food. And so all of that is about suppressing. And
yes.
No, I chose that the only way out of it is actually through it. And so I went deep down into that well, and then working with the plant medicine took me even deeper into that well. And so many people would fear that because talk about going into the ground of your being. You're seeing everything. I mean, I dove into my wound. I went all the way in. Interesting I would say the word well, because it's a well. You go into the deep, dark well. That's where the resources are. That's where the wisdom is. And then you come out of that. Right. You come out of that, and you can see and you can heal. This is about healing. It's not about suppressing. It's not about escaping or running away. This is about healing. And so we can conclude this whole talk with the statement that what this society needs, what people in this society, this culture, require more than anything else at this time is a healing.
Oh, tell me about it. We sure do. We need a healing.
It's profound. Yep.
Because once you're able to heal, you're able to move forward. And yes, I mean, the society is built upon pharmaceuticals. You know, everything that you take is to suppress yourself, to cover your wound, to cover your emotions, feeling like zombies. They turn you into zombies. And all it takes is going within and facing your fear, facing that, going all the way, like you're saying, and being able to face it. And that's what I do a lot with my NLP work and hypnotherapy as well, being able to face it, not run away from it. And it totally shifts your whole perception. But I would like to get more into it, but I'm going to be going back to the Yucatan, actually. I'm going back to that area within the next month. But definitely, so you said it's pretty much available everywhere there, correct?
Oh, in the Yucatan? Oh, no. That I don't know. I mean, there are places where it grows, put it that way.
Okay.
And so I knew of a place where it grew. Someone told me, and I was able to procure. But, you know, it's like anything. You can procure. You know what I mean? If you're seeking enough, you will find
right.
it. You will find
exactly.
it.
Exactly.
Absolutely.
That's a good
yeah.
idea.
Yeah. Wonderful.
Definitely should try. I mean, here in Mexico, I'm in Mexico. It's not, you know, drugs aren't really looked at very hardcore like it is in the States. You know, like you could be, you know, if a cop finds you with marijuana, whatever, it's not a big deal. It's not illegal to have any drugs here. It's just not having too much where you're selling it. That's the only thing because, you know, the cartel wants to be able to sell it. You know, that's the control
right.
thing.
Well,
but,
what do you think
as,
we have here?
You know?
The cartel, the CIA
exactly.
and whatnot is, you know.
Exactly.
Plus, they're not getting any taxes on it.
I know. Tell me about it. So, yeah, and, you know, total control. But, you know, if you smoke it and you have, like, about a certain amount of grams, I mean, they're not going to condemn you for it. Like, okay, yeah, sure, you know, and you give them 20 pesos or 200 pesos, they shut up and they move on their merry little way. But it's just how it is. And in the States, they make it feel like, thou shalt not smoke, you know. Like
well, there's a puritanical element yeah. in there in the States, but there's also, it really... The gist of it was to target specific ethnic groups.
Oh,
and,
really?
And so if you, yes, of course, sweetie. And so if you look at who's in jail for victimless crimes, right? The majority of them are black men and Native American men and Latino, you know, and all these beautiful men, you know, and women.
Uh-huh.
And a lot more white people, you know, finding themselves there as well, right?
Right.
And of course, jails are now privatized, so there's big, big money, big
oh,
money.
Yeah.
You
yeah.
know, I mean, this is
big
what's
money.
Got to stop. It's immoral. It's cruel, like just indescribable cruelty. And this is what breaks my heart. And,
yeah. Yes, I think what we're trying to summarize basically for everyone who wants to be free, it's not just document work, and I've always believed that myself. It's not, and I've always put that out there, it's not really document work, it's mostly Gnosticism or going within inside yourself, Gnosticism. You know, it's a way of going within, finding the answers within, finding out who you are, remembering who you are. And giving it a try, you know, try out these plants, they're Mother Nature. And I mean, this is just so amazing listening to your wisdom and your energy, filling your energy on top of it too. it's wonderful. And I mean, it's absolutely amazing. A lot of information, because what you're doing, it's not, you're bringing everything together. And that's so awesome, because that's exactly what I've been trying to do. It's trying to make sense of everything going on, because it's not just, you know, the 3D, the physical, and what you have in your hands. Everything, you got to bridge everything together, spirit, mind, soul, body, all the stuff, in order to make sense of what is really going on. But I think once we're able to go in and journey within, things are going to be changing, and we're going to be able to look at them in a whole nother light, because I already look at them completely different. I've been looking at them completely different for the past 4 or 5 years, knowing that, wow, these are a bunch of pranksters. This is a joke, you know?
Yeah, pretty
but
cruel.
But going about it in a peaceful way, trying to find out how to do
absolutely.
It, and, you know?
Right. And that is the way of the human being. That is the, you know, it's the way of grace and dignity and humility. And I will do a last plug for my book, Love and Spirit Medicine, which can be found on Amazon. And my website is shaunahome.com, which is shaunahhome.com. And the book is, it's a beautiful story and guide for the reverent use of this medicine.
Yeah, I was going to ask you if it was going to be. Yeah, I was going to ask you if it was going to be a guide too to help help you.
Yeah, I mean, it's not like a how-to. It is a personal story, but you know, I detail my experiences and I go into personal shadow as well. There's shadow and projection, and you know, there's a lot of wisdom there that can be culled from, and then I encourage anyone to, you know, don't hesitate to get in touch with me if you want to have questions.
Yeah.
Or, you know, I work with people via Skype and
oh, definitely.
And
oh, my gosh. Yeah. That'd be so awesome. I would love to contact you, too. My God. contact you.
Great.
More.
I would love it.
Yeah, because I really would love to experience this as well. I mean, this would be so absolutely amazing. Do you do online, too, or is it just mostly
yes,
like
I work online. I work with actually a number of clients via Skype.
Really?
And,
Oh my gosh, this is exciting.
Because Owl will come through, so I bring through Owl, and I do a lot of work on Skype. I don't know what I would do without Skype.
Wow, so that is absolutely amazing. So, like, if we were to do a group thing on Skype, we could do that.
Sure, yeah, and I've done teleclasses before. I don't have one upcoming, but I need to put one together for September, so there's teleclasses I will offer, and sure, yeah.
Oh, my God, because, girl, this is a key right here. This is a huge key for everybody. I mean, this is absolutely important, Shauna, you know, like you're saying about the ancient oracles, I mean, in Norway and all these other places. I mean, and they're doing it all the time in Ecuador, you know.
They're
tapping in, and it's like it's time for us to get back to that. I mean, this is very exciting, guys. Very exciting, and thank you so much. I only got like a couple more minutes, but thank you so much, Shauna, for this amazing show. We can go on all night long.
I know. Well, we'll talk later, but I thank you for having me on your show. It was an honor
Definitely.
And so fun talking to another kindred and another owl woman. I love it.
Yes. Oh, my gosh. So meant to be, wasn't it?
Yeah.
All right.
Well, you take care.
Thank you, and thank you so much, everyone, for listening, and hope you've learned a lot from this show tonight. Okay, thank you so much. Bye-bye, everyone.
Okay. Bye-bye.
Okay, thank you so much. Bye-bye, everyone.
Okay. Bye-bye.
Okay, thank you so much. Bye-bye, everyone.
Okay. Bye-bye.
Okay, thank you so much. Bye-bye, everyone.
Okay. Bye-bye.
Okay, thank you so much. Bye-bye, everyone.
Okay. Bye-bye.